Hi guys and welcome back. Omores here running Windows NT 3.1 on Intel Ivy Bridge i7-3770 CPU on real hardware, of course, you know me. The idea of installing Windows NT 3.1 came when I ran into this Q67 Intel desktop board and I noticed there is a floppy connector. This must be one of the last Intel motherboards with a floppy controller, and you know what? A bootable floppy is actually required during the Windows NT 3.1 setup. But before starting installation as usually, to get you in the mood, here is a short video insert from 1993, the year when Windows NT was released.
Mike, I have Windows 3.1 running over here on my HP Vector. You have Windows NT running over there on your machine. They look almost identical. What is the difference?
Really, Stuart, the idea was to make them look as much the same as was possible. They both use the same familiar program manager, and in fact, a lot of the tools, like the file manager, are exactly the same. In fact, if you could launch
I'll launch
your machine,
my file manager in 3.1, you launch yours in NT.
You see, they're basically the same. I've got a few extra things that aren't there on Windows 3.1. For instance, I can have long file names. A file like name something like the Computer Chronicles can have a space in it, uh-huh, or whatever special characters I want to use. You'll also notice that Windows NT automatically generates a short file name so that older DOS applications can be 100% compatible on Windows NT. Windows NT is also designed to be a secure operating system, so we actually have full support to control the permissions and see who can look at a file. The Computer Chronicles plan can be viewed by anyone, but we want to make sure that all the power users have full access to this. So we'll simply go in, choose power users from the list, add them, give them full control, uh-huh, and now they can access this file in any way they want.
Now we are back to our Q67 motherboard. Let's make sure that the floppy controller is enabled and the floppy drive works. All good. Next, let's check if the SATA controller is set to IDE mode. This step is crucial. However, having the IDE mode available does not guarantee that our boot drive can be initialized. To be recognized by Windows NT 3.1, our IDE controller must act like an ISA device. This is the legacy IDE mode. If our IDE controller acts like a PCI device, usually described as native or compatible IDE mode, then Windows NT 3.1 installation will end with an inaccessible boot device blue screen. So what IDE mode is using this motherboard right now? Well, we don't know yet. Some motherboards will let us switch between legacy and native modes. In this case, we just have to see if we get a blue screen or we can move on with the installation. If our installation drive is not recognized, the only solution is to use a PCI controller with dedicated Windows NT 3.1 drivers, and these are not easy to find. Anyway, the presence of a floppy controller somehow indicates that this motherboard is more legacy friendly and is using IDE and legacy mode. And indeed it is, because as we can see on the screen, our drive is recognized. Problem solved. Of course, if we don't get any info from our BIOS, we can check if the IDE legacy mode is present with a hardware info tool like System Information Viewer. In legacy mode, our primary IDE channel must use RQ14 and secondary channel RQ15. At the next restart, the graphical part of the installation will begin, and that's the whole process. No special moves are required unless the setup gets confused about what type of CPU is in use and it will refuse to install. This is not always the case, depends on how our BIOS will report the CPU, but if it happens, it can be easily fixed by doing some minor edits into setup files. Et voila! We are almost done with the installation. So far, so good. On this configuration, no special actions were required. The setup started from a DOS bootable partition and all went smooth without a single error while using a 3.4 GHz i7 CPU. This is not exactly a surprise, since Windows NT was meant to be installed on multiple platforms, so it has from scratch a better design. And since we are speaking about portability, let's watch another short video insert from 1993.
Two of the nice features of Windows NT are portability and scalability. Here to show us what that means are Ray Court of Microsoft, and also back with us, Mike Nash of Microsoft. Ray, we're going to start with you and talk about portability, and what does that mean?
Well, what we have here is the same consistent Windows user interface, but of course, it's Windows NT that's running here, and it's running on a different microprocessor chip.
All right, so what do we have over here on this NetPower PC?
Well, they say that seeing is believing. If I use this little utility here, I can show you what hardware we have installed in this machine. If I choose hardware, you can see that my CPU type is actually a MIPS microprocessor.
So we're not running a 486 or a Pentium here. This is a MIPS R4000, and we're running NT.
Correct.
What's the advantage to me of...
Windows NT is also portable in another way, not necessarily intended by Microsoft, but we can take our installation drive and use it on another configuration. So let's make a test on a next generation motherboard with a H81 chipset, which also can operate a SATA drive in IDE mode. But what mode? I don't know. We are about to see. Well, if we get a blue screen with inaccessible boot device message, then most likely our motherboard is not using the IDE legacy mode. No problem, we can make another test, this time on a Gigabyte Z68 motherboard running the same i7-3770 CPU. Well, this BIOS will let us disable the IDE native mode, so the legacy mode can be used instead. This way, we should get Windows NT 3.1 running. Let's see. NT Detect is checking hardware, looking good. And yes, 64 megabytes of RAM. Our partitions are marked as clean. Mission accomplished. Let's take a print screen with our i7 CPU. Then let's upgrade from 64 megabytes to about 3 gigabytes. The video card I'm using right now, it's a GeForce 7900 GS. This card will upscale the signal up to full HD, but the base resolution is 800 by 600. Now, how about more RAM? Well, it's doable. For this, we have to use some updated system files. NTDetect.com, the hardware detection component that is in service with every Windows NT released before Windows Vista, is actually backward compatible. So we can take an updated NTDetect from 2003, meant for Windows 2K, and we can use it with Windows NT 3.1 from 1993. This way, Windows NT can use all the RAM available for a 32-bit operating system. If we choose to use an updated ntdetect.com, we have to use an updated version of NTLDR as well. As you can see on the screen, NTLDR designed for Windows 2K is now in charge, but it will load Windows NT 3.1 without any issues. And now we have 3.7 gigabytes of RAM in Windows NT 3.1. Now let's double check our RAM. Total physical memory 3.747648. Basically we have way more RAM than we actually need considering the software compatibility of Windows NT 3.1. Right now we are inside Windows NT 3.51 installation folder. Well, what do you know? We can't run any basic 32-bit app like Notepad or CD Player. This happens because Windows NT 3.51, released just 2 years later, was designed to be compatible with Windows 95 API, while Windows NT 3.1, being the first 32-bit operating system, has its own approach when it comes to 32-bit software. For example, this 32-bit WinZip was specifically written for Windows NT 3.1 and it simply works. However, later versions of Windows are backward compatible with Windows NT 3.1 32-bit software. Now we are in Windows 10 inside the NT 3.1 system folder and we can run natively many 32-bit apps released in 1993 or maybe 1994, the date of the last service pack release. Now we are back to Windows NT. Meanwhile, I installed a S3 Trio PCI video card and now we have 32-bit color depth. Not that this would make any difference when it comes to Windows interface, but it's nice to have. Letting aside 32-bit software, let's not forget that Windows NT 3.1 is fully compatible with Windows 16-bit software and there is a huge library available, even at the time in 93, 94, not to mention later releases until Windows 95 took over. We will continue exploring NT3.1 in a future video, more focused on the networking capabilities. And once we get online, I bet we can stay there for years before getting infected. Let's not forget that Windows NT won't run any Windows standard 32-bit code, so I want to see a virus that will convince Windows NT to run its own code. Won't happen. Stay tuned for the next video, and thanks for watching.